Broadcasting across California, you're watching The Issue Is.
We continue our series of interviews with the presidential candidates with Marianne Williamson. Good to have you back in our studio today.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
All right, Marianne has written a series of best-selling books, including a worldwide phenomenon called A Return to Love, which you see right there. She also founded Project Angel Food, which delivers meals every day to some of California's most vulnerable residents. Marianne was last in our studios back in 2019 when running for the Democratic nomination. In March of this year, she made this announcement.
I, as of today, am a candidate for the office of President of the United States.
Since then, she's been traveling around the country making the pitch on why voters should choose her. Marianne Williamson, welcome back to The Issue
Is. Thank you. Thank you so much.
So, why are you running?
I'm running because some things need to be said and some things need to be done. We need to make a just transition from a dirty economy to a clean economy, from a war economy to a peace economy, and we need to make an economic U-turn in this country. We have 1 in 4 Americans who live with medical debt. We have 1/3 of America's workers who live on less than $15 an hour, can't even find a place to live. Our seniors, we have half of our seniors living on less than $25,000 a year. We have 70% of our people who report living with constant economic anxiety. And the system as it is so geared towards greater obeisance to the profit-making goals of huge corporate entities, as opposed to the health and safety and well-being of the American people, that status quo will not disrupt itself. It will take somebody from the outside who comes in and says we need to turn the ship around.
And part of the foundation of what you want to do is what you call the economic bill of rights.
Right.
What is that, and how do you actually get that passed given the constraints of the system?
Right. So Franklin Roosevelt wrote an economic bill of rights. He said that there are 4 freedoms. 2 of them are freedoms of, and 2 of them are freedoms from. Freedom of religion, freedom of protest and expression. But then he talked about the freedom from fear and the freedom from want. He said that a necessitous man is not a free man. And so his economic bill of rights, which I've updated for the 21st century, allows for universal health care. It allows for tuition-free college at public colleges and universities and tech schools. It allows for always the right for collective bargaining. It allows for child care. It allows for paid family leave and guaranteed housing and guaranteed sick pay and a guaranteed living wage.
Okay, so we know there are a lot of Democrats that would love to have all that happen.
Yeah.
But you've got a very split Congress,
yes.
Right? You got a filibuster that is still in place in the Senate, and you've got a conservative Supreme Court. So how do you make that happen, given all of that?
Well, every president is hoping that the House and the Senate will be of his or her party.
Yeah.
That goes, you know, and the president doesn't have a magic wand. We don't want the president to have a magic wand. There are 3 co-equal branches of government, although somebody needs to tell the Supreme Court that right now. So the president does what the president can do. The president can do executive orders. The president can set the vision. And that's the most important thing. Roosevelt also said that the most important aspect of the presidency is not the administrative aspect, but moral leadership. The president has the bully pulpit, and I would use it. And I would talk about a vision of America in which we return to a government of the people, by the people, and for the people, which Lincoln told us at Gettysburg would not perish from the earth. It is perishing now. For all intents and purposes, we're a government of the corporations, by the corporations, and for the corporations. The American people would not see everything accomplished in my 4 years that I've talked about. That's not how our system operates. But the American people would see the beginning of all those things. And a generation would be ready to take it from there in 4 years.
So inherently, in running against the current Democratic president, you're saying that you could better accomplish those things than the Democratic president that's in place right now. At the White House, Karine Jean-Pierre was asked about you and essentially kind of mocked you. Here's what happened.
If I had a little globe here,
crystal
ball, then I can tell you. But I imagine eight ball, whatever. If I could feel her aura, I just don't have anything to share on that.
How do you respond to that?
Well, I hope that everybody realizes that was not a spontaneous moment. The reporter who asked her about me clearly had been set up to do that. The president had said on his first day in office that if anyone in his administration showed disrespect to anyone, he would fire them on the spot. So I guess my first question is, why does she still have her job? I also hope that the American people see that that's how vicious the system is. There is a refusal to allow anyone into the conversation who does not toe the line with their pre-prescribed conversation if they can at all help it. But as was once said about Elizabeth Warren, I continue to persevere, and people see what that's about.
Well, let's talk about the president's record, because you're essentially running against him. Is there a single example of something that you think that you could have done and realistically gotten through based off of the constraints of everything that happened that he didn't do?
The president did not have to okay the Willow Project. The Willow Project is an $8 billion ConocoPhillips oil extraction project on the North Slopes of Alaska. Now, the president brags about his admittedly healthy investment in green energy that is in the Inflation Reduction Act. However, the Willow Project completely nullifies all of that, and the president has given more oil drilling permits than Trump did. The president is ramping up fossil fuel extraction at the same time that we need to be ramping it down, and his investments in green energy do not counteract that. The president also said that we would have a higher minimum wage. He did achieve that for federal workers. When it came time to try to put it in the COVID relief bill, the parliamentarian said no. I assure you, the Republicans would not allow themselves to be stopped by the parliamentarian. We have not raised the minimum wage in 13 years. It's $7.25 an hour. You have one-third of America's workers who live on less than $15 an hour, and half of them cannot even find a place to live.
But do you think there'd be the Republican votes in the House and the Senate to do that?
Listen, if he had the House and he had the Senate, get rid of the filibuster if you need to.
But how could he do that? That's a Joe Manchin, Kristen Sinema needed to do that, and they weren't willing to give those votes.
You know what George Bush did when the parliamentarian got in his way? He fired the parliamentarian. This was not a Joe Manchin thing. This was the convenience of the fact that the parliamentarian. The president takes an incremental approach to repairing the lives of so many people. Listen, I give him credit for having beaten Trump in 2020. I have certainly respect for the man as a human being. This is not personal. But it does not logically follow that because he beat him in 2020, that he necessarily is the best candidate for 2024. And the Democrat and Democratic-leaning electorate should have a chance at debates to hear the president, to hear Robert Kennedy, to hear myself, so that they can make that decision. The president represents that corporate wing of the Democratic Party, no matter what they say about how he's so Rooseveltian. Actually, no, he's not. It's a very low bar at this point when you talk about what the president has done. So, not compared to Roosevelt, but if you're going to be honest about what's happening. This is a viewpoint that wants to ameliorate the suffering of people, but refuses to challenge the corporate forces that make the return of all that suffering inevitable. And I will challenge them. You can't have it both ways at a certain point. Either corporations and short-term profits for corporations is the governing principle of this country, or democratic and humanitarian values is. We can't have it both ways.
You know, there's been so much conversation this week about this no labels and this concept of a third party, maybe a centrist way forward. If it ends up becoming Biden versus Trump, do you back Joe Biden in that race?
You know, George Washington warned us about political parties in his farewell address. In fact, John Adams then went on to say he saw it as the biggest threat to democracy. And the reason that Washington had a problem with them is because he said that men would become more loyal to their factions and to their party than to their country. My loyalty is to my country. We now have a corporate matrix, insurance companies, pharmaceutical companies, big ag, big oil, big chemical companies, gun manufacturers, big oil, and defense contractors. They run this country. I will do whatever I can this year in order to provide people with the option of turning that, repudiating that. We repudiated that kind of aristocratic rule in 1776, and it's time to repudiate it again.
But wouldn't that get worse under Trump versus Biden?
Absolutely. I will do whatever it seems to me is the greatest possibility of making sure that the fascists do not get the White House in 2024.
And that may be, or most likely would be, I'm not going
there. I don't. I can only tell you what's true in my heart right now.
Got it.
And what's true in my heart right now is I will do whatever it seems to me is my greatest service to the country.
You tweeted out this week some frustrations with Israel and their current leadership. Can you talk about what you think about what they're doing and what you would like to do in president in regards to them?
Well, first of all, let me say I am Jewish. Yeah. And I love Israel. So let me make that very clear. But I'm running for president of the United States. So I say, as a Jew and as a lover of Israel, what is happening in Israel right now is the most far-right government in their history. And we must be honest here. The occupation is illegal. The settlements are illegal. The blockade of Gaza is a terrible injustice. And so sometimes you tell your friends the truth. The United States must hold Israel to the same standards that we would hold any government to. There is a memorandum of understanding where that $3.8 billion is given in military aid until 2028. However, the U.S. president can, and I would absolutely insist that money, none of that money, no American money goes towards things which violate our principles of human rights. And I would do that. I would not take a hands-off approach. Donald Trump went right with the right wingers in Israel. Mm-hmm. Biden, hands off. I would be hands on. I believe that our guiding principle has to be our Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal. That doesn't just mean all Americans. We must stand for both Israelis and Palestinians for robust both security and human rights. And I would.
Let's talk a little bit more about what's happening here in this country. You have this deep economic anxiety, which you saw this week out at the strike for the actors. Writers are on strike. But not only that, you see SEIU, you see UPS workers, you see workers all over the country on strike. What do you think's happening? And almost fundamentally at the soul of this country, which is something you've studied for so many years, where there's so much economic anxiety.
What's happening is that over the last 50 years, 40 to 50 years, there has been a massive transfer of wealth to the tune of $50 trillion from the bottom 90% of Americans. And the top 1% to 10% now hold a gargantuan and obscenely unfair amount of the wealth and the resources of this country. During the 1970s, and I remember this, the average American worker had decent benefits, could afford a house, could afford a car, could afford a yearly vacation, could afford for one parent to stay home if they wanted, and could afford to send their kids to college. Mm. People had the bandwidth to be with their families. They had the bandwidth to be involved in civic engagement. We have put people into a state of such chronic anxiety. You've got 60% of Americans who live paycheck to paycheck, a huge proportion of Americans who could not afford to absorb an unexpected $400 expenditure. Mm. Now, here in Los Angeles, you mentioned that I founded Project Angel Food. So I have a 40-year career working on repairing people's lives. However, I have to tell you, no amount of private charity, no amount of personal transformation can compensate for a basic lack of social justice. This is no longer functioning as a democracy. We're functioning as an oligarchy. This of the people, by the people, for the people shall not perish from the earth. It is perishing now. We're a government of the corporations, by the corporations, for the corporations, and the hour is late. So the idea of incremental change is just managing a terrible decline going on in this country. We must take action now. I realize, and I think millions of us realize, the status quo will not disrupt itself. We have to do it. The people have to do it.
Let's talk for a moment about some of the work that you've done here with Project Angel Food.
Yeah.
This really incredible organization which feeds seniors every day, feed some of the most vulnerable people. Can you tell us a little bit about the story behind it, and what do you think the lessons we all can learn from the success of that program?
Los Angeles should be very proud of itself. Back in the 1980s, when I started lecturing here, very soon thereafter, AIDS just burst onto the scene all over the country, really all over the world, but Los Angeles was very hard hit. and in a way, and it was mainly affecting the gay population. In a very real way, gay men in LA gave me my career. Then what happened, because the gay population always has been and remains so disproportionately contributive in the arts, Hollywood was so hit. You know, writers, directors, actors, filmmakers, photographers. And so Hollywood really opened its heart. So when we started something called the LA Center for Living that gave non-medical support to people living with HIV and AIDS, and then when we started Project Angel Food, it was quite a historic moment. Bette Midler was involved, Elizabeth Taylor was involved, Tony and Barry Perkins, some of the biggest names in Hollywood, David Geffen, Barry Diller, all those. Hollywood really opened its heart, and Project Angel Food began, which is a Meals on Wheels type program. But of course, that was, you know, over 25 years ago, and so, you know, even though I am honored and, you know, feel very proud, yes, at what we began, generations after generations of leadership, even unto today, continue to do great work with it. There will be the groundbreaking of a new building at the beginning of August, and my hat's off to all of the really marvelous people who have kept that alive. And I feel that it is at this point this sort of shining foundational light in the sky of Los Angeles, and I think a lot of people should feel very proud of that. There was a terrible, terrible thing that happened here, and the city responded. And I know, because I was there.
And a show about the importance of compassion and lifting each other up as well. We want to have a little bit of fun. We do something called personal issues on this
okay.
game. This is 30 seconds, rapid fire. We get to know your cultural favorites and get to know you a little bit better. So here we go. What is your favorite TV show?
Well, I think right now, because Fran Drescher's so in the news, I'm thinking about The Nanny.
The Nanny. All right. Who's your favorite author other than yourself?
Oh, wow. Tolstoy.
Who's your favorite athlete of all time?
I don't know, Mark Spitz, because he was the first Jew that showed that you could do athletics at that level.
Do you have a favorite book?
Well, there's a book called Letters to a Young Poet by the poet named Rilke, Rainer Rilke, and along with Pride and Prejudice, I read it every couple years.
And lastly, who's your role model?
My parents.
And why is that?
My mother for her goodness, my father for his don't let the bastards get you down, little sister. I think about that a lot right now.
Well, very nice. Last time you were on, you talked about your favorite music and you talked about your love of Motown.
Okay,
so we're gonna play some music. This is The Temptations.
Uh-huh.
Get ready. Because everybody's got to get ready for you, because here you come, right?
That's right.
Up next, we've got a different view from Republican leader James Gallagher. But first, we go to break with music from The Temptations. Marianne Williamson, thank you for coming
in. Thank you.
Best of luck on the campaign trail.
Thank you.
Right back with more of The Issue Is after this.